outside. We pray that it'll be dry. We know it will be warm. And we ask you to plan for that, to come together once again for a wonderful fellowship of brothers and sisters in Christ. Judica and Rodney are coming from South Africa this week, and they want to send to you a very loving and warm greetings this morning. And if you're watching us this morning so far away, welcome back home, Judica and Rodney and Courtney. Next week, we are going to have an ordination of our elders. It's going to be a very special moment, and we pray that you will all be here to support the ordination of men and women who are leading our church spiritually and in every way. So this morning, as we are about to worship, I want to really welcome our speaker for today, Pastor Matt Parra, his wife Cherise, and their boys. There they are at the back. We are so blessed to have them as a couple who have come all the way from, is it America or further north? Both. They've been here with us for a number of years, and what a huge blessing they are, especially in the area of evangelism and being the brothers and sisters in Christ. So may the Lord richly bless you. Relax wherever you are at home. If you're not well, we pray the Lord will heal you. Come and join us when you can, and may God's blessing be with us now.
I think we really need to stand and sing this beautiful song. We all know that we can't sing properly sitting down. So let's stand and sing this beautiful song, Come and Sing Praises. Tell me where that song that we've just sung came from. A book. It came from Psalms. We've just sung Psalms 29, 1 and 2 to music. It's a beautiful way to remember. It's a beautiful way to praise our God. And I think the people who wrote that tune quite a few years ago now, were blessed by God. I want to welcome you all today. For those of us who are here, we get the benefit of having the soup and buns lunch afterwards. For those who are watching, you can just dream. Until one day maybe you come back and join us too on the first Sabbath of the month for soup and buns lunch. We want to welcome Matt and his family here today. We look forward to what you have to share with us. And we just pray that each one of us will be blessed as we worship. Thank you. If you want to stand, you can, as we sing, "We Are His."
We are His hands to touch the world around us. We are His feet to go where He may lead. And we are His love burning in the darkness. We are His love shining in the night. We are His eyes to see the need in others. We are His voice to tell of His return. And we are His love burning in the darkness. We are His love shining in the night.
Thank you for singing. Now time for us to worship God in another way, and that is by giving. Today it's for local church budget, and as we all know, that's an important offering because it's what keeps this facility running. It keeps the air conditioning and the heating going. It keeps the lights on. It helps us reach out to our community. So we just pray that you will dig deep as this offering is collected. You know that there are several ways that you can give, and some people do give online. Some people give by direct debit. The offering bags will be taken around for those who, like me, like to put it in the offering bag. Let's just bow our heads for prayer. Lord, we thank you so much that we have this privilege of giving to you. We pray that the offering that we give today will be used wisely to bless those around us. For Jesus' sake, amen.
If there's any kiddos here, you're welcome to come to the front. Come on, join us, guys. Join us. We've got a few kids here, I know, because I've got four. Okay, where do the kids sit and where do I go? Okay, hey, guys. Okay, you sit here. You sit here. Have a seat, guys. Welcome to Children's Story. All right. All right. Three of you are mine. So you better behave yourselves. All right, guys, you've heard this story before. I've just told it once, just so you know, last Sabbath, but I'm going to tell it again this Sabbath. So don't spill the beans to these guys, okay? Don't let them know what this story's all about. Hey, guys, how many of you have ever had a pet before? Could you raise your hand? Okay, you too have had pets. You've had a pet, Desmond? Really? I didn't know that. What pet did you have, Bubba? You had a lizard pet. Oh, very nice. What kind of pets did you guys have? A dog? You had a dog. Unreal. My boys, they really want a dog.
What? I have 2 cats and 3 dogs.
Oh, you're kidding me. You have more pets in your house than you have people, don't you? No, you have more people? That's amazing. What? What kind of dogs do you have?
Great Dane Cross Mastiff.
Mastiff, Great Dane Cross. Okay, you forgot the other two. That's fine. I'm sure they don't mind that you forgot. That's excellent. Do you guys want a dog?
Yeah, come on, give us one.
Give you a dog. Now, what's so good about having a pet dog? What do you guys think? What's the...
Play with you.
Okay. Companionship when you're lonely.
They get to rub its belly.
They get to rub its belly? Oh, wow. Okay, fantastic. Well, guys, I have a short story for you about a very special dog. This dog was a girl dog, and her name was Roselle. Now, Roselle was born in California and in a particular kennel that existed for the purpose of training guide dogs. Have you guys ever heard of a guide dog before? Yeah, what do guide dogs do? Oh, we have a guide dog in church today. Fantastic. What do guide dogs do? What are they trained to do?
Guide people.
They guide people. And they guide people who are visually impaired, people whose eyes don't work, who are blind. Is that a good thing that they do, or is that a bad thing that they do?
Good thing.
It's a good thing. It's an amazing thing, isn't it? Guide dogs are awesome, beautiful little creatures. Now, there are places that exist to train guide dogs, to teach them how to guide people. They do a noble, good job. Now, this guide dog, Roselle, was owned by a man who lived in New York City. Pretty long time ago for you guys. It was back in the year 2001 that Roselle was assigned to her owner or her master to guide him from place to place so that he could live a normal life, so that he could live a more full and free life. Because if he didn't have the guide dog to help him, then his life would not be as good. This man worked in a place called the World Trade Centers. World Trade Centers are two big giant buildings that used to stand in New York City, but no longer stand in New York City because they were attacked and they fell down. So planes flew into them. I mean, could you imagine? Like two airliners crashed into these two giant buildings in New York City and they caught on fire and... they fell down, which is horrible. Well, we can talk about that some other time, about how the World Trade Center was bombed and attacked. Now, this particular man, he worked on the 76th floor of the World Trade Center. He was at work there doing his job when one of the planes struck his tower a few floors above him. When the plane struck the building, it was like a big, loud noise. A hot flash of light, the building started shaking, glass started breaking, people started screaming, it was chaos, it was pandemonium. And the man was at his desk, and Roselle was under the desk, and she was sleeping. She woke up and was startled, and the whole room just went crazy. People didn't know what to do, they were so terrified, they were so scared, there was smoke everywhere, they could hardly see. But Roselle was trained so good, so properly, that she kept her calm, she kept her cool, and she just began to lead her owner out of the building. But not just her owner, she began to lead 30 other people out of the building, down the floors from down the stairs from floor to floor to floor to floor. She was taking them down 76 flights of stairs. The firemen came and were running up the steps, and she stopped to greet them, just like it was a normal day of work. Anyways, long story short, guys, Roselle was responsible for not only saving the life of her master, who she guided out of the burning building, she also saved the life of 30 other people who tagged along for the ride. Now, is that a good thing? Yes or no? Is that an awesome dog? Boy, she's a special dog. Now, she didn't realize that she was so special because her owner said when he took her home, she just greeted his other dog like it was just a normal day and began to play and eat some snacks and treats and just go about her day. Okay, this is not just a story about a dog. It's a story that teaches us a very, very valuable lesson. God has promised to give us his Holy Spirit. And his Holy Spirit, like Roselle, is a guide. We are like the blind man and those people who are in a very difficult situation in this world because people get diseases, they die, we have all kinds of conflict and difficulty here. But the Holy Spirit can guide us safely out of all difficulties and into safety. Now, I didn't tell you guys this, but as soon as they got out, they were about 50 to 70 meters away from the building that the other building came crumbling down. And not too long after that, their building came crashing down. Now, what would have happened if people who were in that building that was burning didn't follow Roselle? They would have died. They would have been lost. And they would have come crashing down with the building when it came crashing down. But the people who followed Roselle were saved. Is that right? So just think about this. God sends you his Spirit to teach you about Jesus and the way we are to go. If we follow, we will live. But if we don't, when the building comes crashing down, we'll be in it. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you for your Spirit. He's faithful, he's awesome, he's friendly, he's committed. He's like Roselle the guide dog. She's like him, guiding us to safety. Bless these kids, Lord. Give them your Spirit. We love our children, and we want them to be healthy, happy, holy, confident, strong young people who can shine their light for you, the light of love and truth. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you guys. Thank you for being fantastic listeners. You can go back to your seats.
I was watching on YouTube one of Gaither's homecoming series, and I heard this beautiful song written in 1966, and yet I'd only heard it recently. And so I have introduced that here to church for us to sing before we lead into prayer. Can you please stand as we sing When God Seems So Near?
Holy presence.
I am your shepherd. You have everything that you need. I will lead you into green pastures. I will guide you beside still waters, and I will allow you to drink. I will restore your soul. I will even lead you in the paths of righteousness for my name's sake. And remember, even though you walk through the valley of the shadow of death, be not afraid. My rod, my staff, my word will comfort you. I will prepare a table before you in the presence of your enemies. I will even anoint you with oil from heaven, and your cup will run over. Surely, believe it, goodness and mercy will follow you all the days of your life, and please stay in my house forever. I love you. I'm your God. Thank you, Jesus, for speaking to us and being such an amazing shepherd. It's too much for us to behold to think that we have such a loving, warm, caring God. This morning, we have come to worship you in gratitude and thankfulness for what you have done and you are doing in our lives. We're so glad that we are still alive with all the things going on. We are still trusting you, even though so much doubt sometimes floats through us and we get discouraged and despondent. You are holding us in the palm of your hands. Thank you for being such a God. And this morning, because of your loving care, we bring before you Jojo and her dear husband, who is in hospital this morning. We pray that you'll be there for him and strengthen him. And our dear sister Wawa and Kayab have been stricken by COVID. Oh, what a miserable experience that is. But if they're listening this morning, may they sense that we love and care for them and that they will be encouraged and healed quickly. As my dear wife Ruth is feeling a little bit, it seems, we don't know what it is. Lord, we thank you for Brother Steve, who is doing so much better, for the blessing that he is as he's improving. But we are thinking of Carol Hompton, who is at home today again after weeks and weeks of suffering and not having her health back. We pray that you will touch her and give her the healing she needs. And may she sense that she is loved and cared for and prayed for. And Lord, we're not thinking only of ourselves, but we're thinking of all the pastors in this conference that are being attacked in some form or another by the evil one. We pray that you will put a shield of protection around them, that they will stand strong in the midst of trial, that thy church members who are right around there seeking to support them and being ministered to, may they also minister to them. And may we, as thy people, survive in this world that is bent on war and destruction as we see it raging up in the North Europe. Oh, Lord, we pray that we will come and see you more clearly, love you more dearly, and trust you all the way through. May your anointing be on Brother Matt as he speaks this morning. May the words that he brings from your word just flow from your heart, and may hear Jesus speak to us. Is our prayer in the beautiful name of Jesus, our shepherd. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. It is my privilege today to do the scripture reading with one of my grandsons. The last time we were meant to do one together didn't quite work out. But we hope you are blessed by the scripture reading today. It's found in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and starts reading from verse 18. And I'm reading from the NLT. I normally have a New King James, but my daughter insisted I read it this version. I read this version today. So, starting from verse 18. The message of the cross is foolish to those who are headed for destruction, but we who are being saved know it is the very power of God. As the scriptures say, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and discard the intelligence of the intelligent. So where does this leave the philosophers, the scholars, and the world's brilliant debaters? God has made the wisdom of this world look foolish. Since God, in his wisdom, saw to it that the world would never know him through human wisdom, he has used our foolish preaching to save those who believe. It is foolish to the Jews who ask for signs from heaven, and it is foolish to the Greeks who seek human wisdom. So when we preach that Christ was crucified, the Jews are offended, and the Gentiles say it's all nonsense.
But to those called by God to salvation, both Jews and Gentiles, Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God. This foolish plan of God is wiser than the wisest of human plans, and God's weakness is stronger than the greatest of human strength. Remember, dear brothers and sisters, that few of you were wise in the world's eyes, or powerful, or wealthy, when God called you. Instead, God chose things that the world considered foolish in order to shame those who think they are wise. And he chose things that are powerless to shame those who are powerful. God chose things despised by the world, things counted as nothing at all, and used them to bring to nothing what the world considers important. As a result, no one can ever boast in the presence of God.
Of scripture, isn't it? Whoa. That's such a good scripture, isn't it? I could just almost sit here today and just listen to the Bible read. I think that might be more beneficial and spiritually uplifting for me than to have to preach. Thank you guys for reading that scripture. Well, I bring you guys greetings from the North New South Wales Conference Evangelism, Personal Ministry, and Sabbath School Department, of which I get the opportunity to serve through. And I want to, before we get into the sermon, just share just a basic bit of information about my department. I'm not going to give you guys a departmental report. I've been doing that from Sabbath to Sabbath at different churches, like giving a little report on what's happening in my departmental ministry, but I'm not going to do that today for the sake of time. I'm just going to flash through a whole bunch of slides and say like a few words about them, and then we'll just kind of get to the end of this little slide presentation, and there's going to be a QR code up on the screen. And if anyone would like to receive a weekly newsletter that my department produces, where we provide podcasts, both on Sabbath School, the Sabbath School Quarterly, and then also about personal witnessing and personal ministries, and other reports and testimonies and information of what's happening in the department, you can pull out your device, your iPad or your phone, and you can just hold it up to the QR code that'll be on the screen, and then that'll send you to a place where you can sign up for our departmental newsletter. And then you can just always know what's happening in my department. So we do online evangelism in our department because of the COVID lockdowns and restrictions and stuff. For the last several years, we've been producing online content. If you get onto our newsletter, you'll learn more about that. These are some series we've done in the last couple years. Just some information about those online evangelism series. We do a lot of training around the conference, and not just Arise, which we do run in my department, but training like Empower that happened at the end of last year in Newcastle, where church members can just come and learn better how to share their faith and get involved in ministry. As I said, we do podcasts each week. One of them is called All Things Evangelism, which is a really cool little opportunity for me to share resources and information to the church members in North New South Wales on how to be better witnesses and better missionaries. This is just some stats from the Bible working team. I manage Bible workers in the conference and volunteers. Other departments have Bible workers and volunteers as well at the conference office. I think young adults department, Kate, you guys have a couple Bible workers now. And I think also the health department in our conference has some volunteers and stuff. But this is a picture of Arise. That's a big part of my ministry here in North New South Wales. It's a discipleship school where we train people to do personal ministries. So I'm personal ministries director. This is a school for personal ministries training for members of our conference. I said to you guys, we produce a weekly Sabbath School commentary. We've just really reformed and reframed how we do this, by the way. And for this quarter's lesson series, our commentary, we've got some really great guests, I'll just let you know. We've got the person who wrote the Sabbath School lesson. He's one of our guests in the Sabbath School commentary podcast series. So if you listen to the podcasts on a weekly basis, they're just 20 to 30 minutes. And one of the commenters for this quarter will be the actual author of the lesson. So we've got the Sabbath School director also from the union who's going to be chiming in. So lots of good guests. I think you guys will love it if you want to get onto it. So there was a Sabbath School summit this year that we supported. It was a union-wide kind of training. And yeah, so anyways, that's a brief picture of what my life is like. I didn't want to give you guys a report because, 90% of you wouldn't remember it in about 20 minutes, and 10% of you would be mad at me for taking so long talking about what I do. So anyways, if you want to get signed up to our newsletter, you can hold up your device or phone and put it on that QR code. And I think, is it taking you guys to a link? Okay, it's taking you there? Yeah, is it working? Okay, it wasn't working for me yesterday, and I was really freaking out, and I had my friend Enrique send me a new one, and I didn't test it out, so I'm glad it works. All right, cool. Hey, one last thing before we pray and get into the sermon. In case you were wondering, I just wanted to make sure you knew that I was not the victim of any domestic violence or abuse. My eye is not puffy and red because my wife got mad at me and backhanded me this week. I mean, that may have happened, but this is not why I have a big red black eye. She looks really nice, but she's a strong woman. But she's not so strong as to abuse me. I actually have a sty in my eye, and I made a unfortunate error last night. I went online and saw that one of the ways that you deal with a sty, which is a clogged tear duct or maybe an eyelash opening that's clogged, it's you put hot compresses on it. That's what all the websites say, WebMD, the Mayo Clinic, everybody says to put hot compresses on it. Well, me being such a pain-tolerant person and such a strong man, I overheated the compresses and I burned my face. So Not only do I have a big swollen eye, I have a burn on my face from where I was putting hot compresses on my face last night. And my wife is having a good time laughing about this, and I'm glad that you appreciate my foolishness. But anyways, that's why I look less than, I don't look as handsome as I normally do, okay? That's all, I had to explain that. So anyways, it's a pleasure to be with you, and thank you, Pastor Miroslav, for your ministry, your leadership, and for letting me have a time to share God's word with the church family here. I want to thank you to all the people who've participated in the worship, the organizers. It's just been a huge blessing to me thus far. Sabbath school was amazing. Thank you to those of you guys who teach Sabbath school and who commit to that ministry. I just want to have a prayer with you guys, and then we'll jump into today's lesson, today's sermon. Dear God in heaven, we come before you now knowing that in ourselves we are poor, blind, miserable, wretched, and naked. But where sin abounds, grace much more abounds. And you're not willing that anyone should perish, and you paid a ransom for all. You were in Christ, Father, reconciling us to yourself. And you don't impute our trespasses to us, and we thank you for that. We love you, Lord, and we thank you for all you've done and all you're doing. And I ask that you give me the Holy Spirit. As we read through this passage of Scripture, please help us to understand what you're saying to us. And in spite of my limitations, my humanness, my fallenness, my selfishness, speak to your people, the church that you love. In Jesus' name, amen. I just needed to get my glasses. Voila. So, the Christian church in the city, the ancient city of Corinth, was divided. People in the church were at odds with one another, and they were rallying around different high-profile preachers. Some were identifying themselves with Apollos, who the Bible says was an extraordinary communicator of God's word. Also, a very powerful man when it came to understanding the teachings of the Bible. Some others were rallying around the Apostle Paul. Some were rallying around Peter, the Apostle. Now, they wanted to do this to distinguish themselves, to show themselves wise and important. Now, it's interesting because if you read 1 Corinthians chapter 1, the Apostle Paul, he affirms the believers in Corinth. He tells them that he believes that their faith is genuine. He says that God has confirmed the genuineness of your faith by giving you the gifts of the Spirit. You don't lack in any gifts. God's confirmed you. He's legitimized you by giving you his Spirit, and you can see the gifts of the Spirit in the church. He basically says, you're the real deal. You are genuine Christian believers. But at the same time, he says, but you're divided. You're fragmented. You're gravitating toward this great preacher and that great preacher. You're distinguishing yourselves by which great preacher you can connect yourself with. And you're all at odds, and you're all fighting, grouchy towards one another. And this is not of God. This is in accordance with the wisdom of the world. You know, in the world, there are superstars, powerful figures that people like to associate with. And in associating with those important people, with those famous people, with those intelligent people, they make themselves great. They make themselves seem brilliant, and they make themselves seem intelligent. This is human. This is earthly. This is carnal. One says, he talks about it again in chapter 3. He mentions it in chapter 1, that they're divided and that they're rallying around high-profile Christian leaders. But then he also mentions it in chapter 3. And he says, so some of you guys say, I'm of Apollos. Others of you say, I'm of Paul. Others of you say, I'm of Cephas. Like, rah, rah, go team, go. He says, isn't this childish? Isn't this carnal? Isn't this silly? You know, now, we read this counsel, and I just want to make kind of a half application. And it seems so distant. It seems so far away. But really, it's not distant. It's not far away. It's very applicable. It's very relevant to us. It's natural. It's inherent for us to want to join a team and find strength and support from that team. You know, like, I went to this university, or I was trained by this respective person. I am of Arise. I am of Avondale. Now, there's nothing wrong with Arise. I love it. I train people at Arise. And there's nothing wrong with Avondale. That's my school. That's my university. I'm a Seventh-day Adventist. Avondale's success is my success. But when we adopt this mindset, right, of I am of, or I am of, it's low, it's carnal, it's immature spiritually. And this is what was happening in the church at Corinth. And it's interesting because the passage that we read in regards to God making the wisdom of the world seem foolish, it's addressing this very thing. It's addressing this thing. People are arrogant and high-minded by nature, and they used wisdom and knowledge to exalt themselves. And he says, listen, didn't God make the wisdom of the world seem foolish? Doesn't God turn to nothing the things that are? Like, he turns everything upside down on its head. People use wisdom, they use knowledge to become powerful and important and to exalt themselves above others. And he says, this is worldly, this is low. Now, this just sets the stage for what I want to do with you guys this morning, and that's just simply to read a few verses in 1 Corinthians chapter 2. So understand the basic picture that I've shared. Does that all make sense? Does you guys follow the picture I'm trying to paint here? I haven't done a perfect job, but I think I've done a good enough job, and then we'll just read the passage that I want to read with you guys this morning. It's in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, and beginning in verse 1. So if you have your Bibles, turn with me in your Bible to 1 Corinthians chapter 2. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, Romans, 1 Corinthians chapter 2. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, we'll begin reading together in verse 1. And our sermon this morning is entitled, The Things of the Spirit of God. This is based on verse 14. Let's read together 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 1. The Bible says, And when I came to you, brethren, this is Paul speaking to the believers in Corinth, I did not come with superiority of speech or of wisdom, proclaiming to you the testimony of God. Now, this is an interesting statement. Paul is telling the Christian believers in Corinth, when I came to do ministry in your city, when I came to plant the church in Corinth, I didn't come to you with superiority of speech or superiority of wisdom. Well, why didn't he? Was it because he wasn't wise? Was it because he wasn't articulate? Was it because he couldn't exercise language in a superior way? No, he's very articulate. He has the capacity to articulate thoughts very well. He is a superior speaker, but he's saying to the people who he converted and the church that he built, remember, when I came and did ministry in the city, I didn't come to you with superiority of speech. I didn't come to you with superiority of wisdom. Or in other words, I didn't try to impress you with how articulate I am. I didn't try to impress you with my deep philosophical insights of the world. That could have impressed you. That could have made a difference. But that's not the spirit that I came to you in. That's what he's saying. But remember, it's not that he didn't possess superiority of speech. It's not that he didn't possess superiority of wisdom. He did. He was very wise, and he was very articulate. But he came to them speaking simply. He came to them being simple, not using all of his great intellectual faculties to impress them. Now, he could have. And we're going to discover why he didn't in just a bit. I determined not to know anything else among you except Jesus and him crucified. So I was singular in my focus when I did ministry here in Corinth, and I focused singularly on the message of the crucified Savior of the world. Now, he says in the previous chapter that the Greeks think that that's foolish, And that it's a stumbling block to the Jews, but that's just what he focused on. We go on. I was with you in weakness, in fear, and in much trembling. So I suffered with you. I came and did personal ministry. I put myself in jeopardy for your sake. I worked hard for you. This is what he's saying. And then he says, and my message and my preaching were not in persuasive words. Some versions of the Bible say enticing words. My message and my preaching were not in persuasive words of men's wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power. Interesting. So I didn't try to draw you. I didn't try to entice you with words of men's wisdom. Well, I wonder why not? Well, why not? Why not draw them with the excellent words of men's wisdom? Well, he says it in the next verse, by the way. It's not a trick question. It's an easy question to answer. He says, notice this, so that your faith would not rest on the wisdom of men, but on the power of God. I could have impressed you, but I chose not to. I could have spoken with the enticing words of men's wisdom, and you would have been, whoa, this guy can speak amazingly. He's so talented at communicating ideas. I could have so impressed you with my deep philosophical insights, and you would have said, this guy has to be sent by God, because who could have such profound comprehension of these philosophical topics? He said, but I didn't do that. Why? Because had I done that, your faith may have rested upon me being talented and impressive, and not upon the simple message of the gospel. I came to you through the Spirit, with the demonstration of the Spirit's power. And I just singularly focused on God's saving message. And that's how you were converted. And now it's ironic because that's how the church was built, but that's not how the church was practicing church. I don't know if you could follow that, but now there's so many lessons that we can learn from this. So many lessons. I'm going to make some applications. So we've been looking at the scripture, the word of God, and now I'm just going to make some applications. And we could probably have a Bible study and all share some applications, but I'm going to just share some applications of this teaching of Paul, this communication of Paul. One thing I get out of this is that you don't have to be great at speaking to make an impact for God. He's saying right here, I didn't come to you with superiority of speech. I spoke very simply. Right? The church at Corinth was built, was planted, and Paul says when he planted it, by Paul, and he says when I planted it, I came to you not with superiority of speech. So you don't have to be a superior spokesperson for God to make a big difference. Amen. Us people who kind of stumble over our tongues and stumble over our words and stumble over our thoughts, there's hope for us. We can do something for God. Paul didn't come with superiority of speech. I think there's a loose connection there to Jonah. Now, I'm not saying that Paul and Jonah are equivalences at all, but I know that Jonah's message was a pretty simple one, and it wasn't that flattering or appealing. But man, it made a difference, didn't it? Like, 40 days and Nineveh will be destroyed. Okay, I could say that. It's not so much how you say things, how articulate you are. It's not so much, you know, how knowledgeable and smart you are. It's all about how in harmony you are with God's Spirit and God's Word. That's the difference. Okay, something else. Paul understood that what you win people with, you win them too. If he won them, with the pure, simple message of the gospel than he won them to the pure, simple message of the gospel. If he won them with his dazzling talent, then he won them to his dazzling talent. Does that make sense? Come on, guys, does that make sense? Help me out here. The dog is really cute. I love him. I want to look at him too, but does that make sense? Is we cool? You guys picking that up? Is that something you can grasp that? So I don't know if it's fair to make this point. You can correct me after the sermon if I'm wrong. We always have to realize that sometimes the accoutrements that we place around the presentation of the gospel can actually become an inhibitor, where a person's experience becomes based upon the presentation and not upon the message itself. So they're not hearing God's communication to them, they're just being swept away by the presentation that they're able to experience. Does this make sense? You follow this? This has a lot of application in how we do ministry. Paul was saying, I was intentional about being simple when I presented the gospel, because I knew that the more production that I presented, the more likely you were going to be to base your faith on the production and become disingenuous Christian believers who didn't really know what you were doing, but just being impressed by my talent, impressed by my amazingness. You follow? This has application in everything. In everything. So when you have the Spirit, you don't need a grand cathedral. When you have the Spirit, you don't need a grand cathedral, and you don't need a light show either. Sometimes a grand cathedral can get in the way. Not necessarily anything wrong with it. I like grand cathedrals. I've been to them. I've been to the grand cathedrals in Austria, Germany, England. There's magnificent cathedrals. Nothing wrong with them. I mean, there's something wrong with the basements that are filled with torture instruments, but the building themselves, there's nothing necessarily wrong with those buildings. But the buildings stand as a grand irony, right? These massive edifices that stand supposedly for the glory of God had torture chambers underneath them and people who didn't really have the Spirit because they were promoting and proliferating unbiblical, ungodly teachings in the name of Jesus. See what I'm saying? And they didn't have the Holy Spirit. They didn't have the power of the Word of God, so they needed to compensate with big cathedrals. And the same thing can happen today. You don't have the Spirit of God like Paul had the Spirit of God, so you can't just preach the simple message, so you have to dress up the message you have to compensate with show, with a showy presentation, and then you don't realize that what you're winning people with is what you're winning people to. And then your presentation of the gospel just becomes a way to welcome people out into the world from the church. You know, anyway, so I could go into it, but once again, okay, just so I don't get myself in trouble with some of you guys. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with artistic presentations, right? Creative expressions. But if that's the thing, no good. And this is, I think, Paul. Could you say amen? Can you see this? This is the text. This is what he's teaching. This is actually what he's teaching. It's the teaching of the Bible here. We'll just go on here. Oh, is there another application I can make here? No. I'm just going to read the rest of the passage, and then we're going to make a few comments, and then we're done. We're going to read verse 5 again. So that your faith would not rest on the wisdom of men, but on the power of God. Yet, he says, we do speak wisdom among those who are mature. So it's not as if I don't have wisdom to share. I do have wisdom to share with those who are mature, those who won't become arrogant when I share my knowledge. However, my wisdom is not of this age, nor of the rulers of this age. So it's not a wisdom that I have derived from the world or from the rulers of the world. They're all passing away. But we speak God's wisdom in a mystery, the hidden wisdom which God predestined before the ages to our glory. So there's a wisdom that comes from God that he destined before the ages, and that's the wisdom I speak. That's what he's saying. The wisdom which none of the rulers of this age who think that they're so wise, have understood. For if they had understood it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. So all these people in the world who maybe have a form, some kind of wisdom, he says, they crucified the Lord of glory. They don't understand God's wisdom. And then he says, just as it is written. So to support the point that he's just made, to support his argument, he says, he quotes a Bible verse. Things which eye has not seen, nor ear has not heard, and which have not entered into the heart of man, all that God has prepared for those who love him. Now, we use this passage typically to talk about what God will give those who love and believe in him at the end of time. Like, eye has not seen, nor ear heard, nor has it entered into the heart of man, things that God has prepared for those that love him. And we make an application of the future blessings that God will give to those who love him. But that's not the primary application of this text. That's not how Paul is using this text. It's okay to use this text this way. There's nothing wrong with this. But what he's saying, he's quoting this verse because he's simply saying they killed Jesus because they didn't understand the wisdom of God, and their eye has not seen, and their ear has... So it hasn't entered into man's mind how God would save him. Like, it's just beyond human capacity to understand. Humans do not possess the capacity to understand God's wisdom. Their eyes haven't seen, their ears haven't heard, neither has it entered into their hearts, the things that God has prepared for those who love him. So God prepared for those who loved him, or love him, salvation through the Son. And they killed him because they didn't understand God's wisdom. Is that any of that, you guys picking that up? Okay. We go on. For to us God revealed them through the Spirit. Ah. Okay, how has God revealed his mystery, his wisdom to us? How? Through the Spirit. For the Spirit searches all things, even the depths of God. So what he get, dude, this is so awesome. Guys, the Bible is so awesome. You don't have to, like, the Bible is so awesome. Like, what this guy is saying here is so profound and so deep and so amazing. And you know how I came to understand what he said, what he's saying? I had to read it like 60 times. Like, it took a bit of work. I just read it and read it and read it and read it and prayed and prayed and prayed and read it. And then the Spirit. But anyways, so here's what's so awesome about what he's saying. He's saying that people do not possess the capacity to understand God's wisdom or to understand the gospel. There's nothing that can humanly be done to come to an understanding of God's wisdom. Nothing. Nothing. But the Spirit can reveal it. The Spirit can reveal it. Think about this. The only way a human person can truly come to know the wisdom of God and the gospel, which is the gospel, is through the Holy Spirit. It's the only way. This is what Paul's teaching. There's no other way. Absolutely no other way. The greatest teacher, Jesus himself, couldn't bring you to a knowledge of the gospel without the Holy Spirit working inside of you. Disciples, anyone? Right? We go on. For who among men knows the thoughts of a man except for the spirit of man which is in him? So he's saying the only person who can understand a man's mind is a human. Even so, the thoughts of God no one knows except for the Spirit of God. Now, we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit of God. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit who is from God, so that we may know the things freely given to us by God, which things we also speak, not in words taught by human wisdom, but in those taught by the Spirit. Combining spiritual with spiritual. Now, this is where we end. The sermon was entitled, The Things of the Spirit of God. But the natural man does not receive or accept the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him, and he cannot understand them, because they are spiritually discerned or understood. But he who is spiritual understands all things. Doesn't mean that you understand everything that there is to understand if you're spiritual. It's saying all things that God has to reveal by the Spirit you can understand if you're a spiritual person or open to the Spirit. Yet he himself is understood by no one. So in other words, the world could think that you're a fool because you accept the gospel because you live in accordance with God's will for your life. They could think that you're foolish, but they don't understand. They're the ones who lack understanding. Now, you, though, who've been given a revelation by the Spirit, you have understanding. And you realize that the wisdom of the world and all those people who think you're foolish are actually foolish themselves. This is what he, this is his message, not mine. Okay, so a couple practical things to leave you with. If we want to win people, we don't need to spice up our ministry. We need the Holy Spirit. We need the Holy Spirit. Because he says it's the only way to bring someone to an understanding and a knowledge of the gospel. It's the only way. You can have the best teacher, you can have the best performance, the best presentation, the most glorious cathedral, and guess what? Without the Spirit, nobody's going to understand the gospel or come to a knowledge of it, because the natural person does not receive the things of the Spirit of God, neither can he know them, for they are spiritually discerned. And nobody understands the mind of God except for the Spirit of God. Only the Spirit of God can reveal the wisdom of God. Men can't do it. The works of human hands cannot reveal God to people. It takes the Spirit. So if we have the Spirit can work through us for the sake of the salvation of others. We get lost in these discussions about methods and tactics and approaches. And the elephant is in the room is, where's the Spirit? It's all about the Holy Spirit. That's really the message. And I told the closing illustration in the children's story, so remember it. The Holy Spirit is that guide dog, that revealer, that interpreter. Not that the guide dog was an interpreter, but he was the guide. But so church, here's just a simple appeal, and we're done with the message. Let us do all in our power to, I don't know how to say this really, God, give us your Spirit. Let's ask God for the Holy Ghost with our mouths and with our lives. If we have the Holy Spirit, we grow. We develop. We understand. He reveals to us. If we have the Holy Spirit, we have power to convert others. And I'll leave you with this. So Jesus, he's having some private time with his disciples. And they've been completely traumatized by the experience of the previous days and weeks. All of their hopes and all of their dreams were dashed completely. Now, it's one thing to have your hopes and dreams dashed when you are just like a person like me who hasn't given very much, relatively speaking, for the gospel. But these guys, they put their lives on the line because they were completely convinced that this Jesus was going to become a military leader and exalt the nation to its former glory. And here he is, he's crucified, he's stripped naked, he's embarrassed, he's shamed. And in their, they're having a complete car crash in their minds and in their hearts when Jesus is crucified. Like, this is, I mean, it would have been rending and tearing and like destructive to their minds and hearts. When they saw Jesus crucified, they just couldn't make sense of it. They're hearing the rumors of him being resurrected. They get a few visions of him. They see him. Anyways, so this has all happened. They're in a room. They're spending time together, private time. And Jesus looks at his disciples, and he says to them something that is just, it's astounding. It's completely astounding. He says to them, this is in John chapter 20. He says, as the Father has sent me, so I send you. Huh? What? That's great. That's a heavy statement. As the Father sent me, so I send you. Okay, so if I would have heard those words, I would have thought to myself, here he goes again, saying these crazy and ridiculous things. Like, he sent you to save the world, to change the world. to usher in the kingdom of God, the true kingdom of God. And then he's going to send me. And then the Bible says he breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Spirit. What he says is ridiculous without the empowering of the Holy Spirit. Dead in trespasses and sins, confused, bewildered, natural, carnal, selfish. Yeah, God's going to send you the way that he sent me. How's that? Here's the Holy Spirit.
Thank you, Matt, for that service and for the challenge that you've left us. Please let us stand and sing our last song, Without You.
Lead me on.
If you love me, keep my commandments. And I'll pray the Father, and he'll send you the Holy Spirit. And we are his witnesses of these things. And so also is the Holy Spirit, who's given to them who obey. You who are evil, you know how to give good gifts to your children. And God is more willing to give the Holy Spirit to those who ask then you are willing to give good gifts to your kids. Dear God in heaven, give us the Spirit. send him to us so that our minds can be open to the truth of the gospel, not just in an abstract, intellectual sense, but in a practical way, so that we could be those foolish things that bring to nothing the things of this world and show the goodness and glory of God. Bless us now, God, as we go our separate ways, whether we're staying here to eat lunch or whether we're going to go home and enjoy a quiet, rainy Sabbath afternoon somewhere with friends or at home. Be with us, God, and give us Sabbath. We thank you and praise you for all you've done, all you're doing, and for your holy word, which is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. Dismiss us with your blessing now, we pray in Jesus' holy name. Amen.